Ashis Nandy and Professor Partha Chatterjee, who are known to many of us for their relentless commitment to deepening our understanding of social architectures and the lives that are involved in it. So we welcome you. May I please invite Ashima and Anupriya to felicitate our guests with flowers. So if you could join us on the dais. We're also joined by the Vice-Chancellor of the University, Professor Sean Lennon, and the Dean of the School of Human Studies, Professor Ashok Mathur.
Thank you very much. Professor Ashis Nandy, Professor Partha Chatterjee, Professor Ashok Nagpal, my colleagues, my dear students, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Today is the spring equinox, according to the Indian solar calendar. In some parts of the subcontinent, they celebrate this day as the beginning of a new year. So I wish all of you a very happy new year. Today is also the 121st birthday anniversary of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The Ambedkar University Delhi community has been celebrating this occasion every year. We celebrate our privilege to be associated with Dr. Ambedkar's name and his ideals. It has always been an inspiring experience to be trying to build a university in Dr. Ambedkar's name. I was just reminded of certain very interesting and inspiring episodes in his life. I wish we had time to talk about it, but all the same, I think this day is our attempt to pay tribute to that great name. Ambedkar University Delhi is completing 4 years of its existence this coming August. Ours was a mandate to pursue excellence in research and higher learning in the social sciences and humanities, while not disengaging from our commitment to help transform our society to one that upholds equality and social justice. It is significant that AUD was created at a time when neoliberal ideologies had already come out of their closets and had begun to shape the destiny of higher education in India and other countries of the global south. The AUD community is conscious, therefore, of the historic opportunity that it has at hand, which is to demonstrate that it is possible for a publicly financed university to bridge concerns of equality and social justice with quality and its excellence, concerns of social transformation with those about economic growth, concerns about social needs with those about market demands. We are also fully conscious of what we are trying to achieve. Our task is not merely to establish just a new institution. Our task is, on the other hand, to create a new institutional culture, a culture based on collegiality, engaged scholarship, and nurturance of creativity. AUD established the Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Memorial Lectures series in 2009. This lecture series is meant to provide a public platform to invite annually an eminent scholar or public personality from among the best minds across the world to share his or her thoughts and reflections through a public lecture, particularly in areas of knowledge and human experience such as democracy, constitutional law, equity, social justice, social transformation, social action, and engaged spiritualities, all areas connected with Dr. Ambedkar and his life. We organize the Dr. Ambedkar Memorial Lecture every year in Delhi, ordinarily on the 14th of April. To commemorate the birth anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar, we hold it in a prominent public venue. We don't hold it on our campus. We see this as an important tribute that Ambedkar University Delhi makes to Dr. Ambedkar. We also see this as our tribute to the city of Delhi and its public life. We have had three distinguished scholars and public intellectuals to deliver lectures under this series so far. Professor Bikhu Parekh delivered the Ambedkar Memorial Lecture, Ambedkar's Legacy, in 2009. In 2010, the lecture was delivered by Professor Veena Das on citizenship as a claim or stories of dwelling and belonging among the urban poor. Professor Deepak Nair delivered the lecture in 2011 on discrimination and justice beyond affirmative action. We have brought out these lectures as monographs. They are available outside. We have had a political philosopher, a social anthropologist, and an economist to deliver the lecture these past 3 years. This year, we are fortunate to have the most distinguished political psychologist of our times, Professor Ashis Nandy, to deliver the fourth Ambedkar Memorial Lecture. He's speaking this evening on theories of oppression and dialogue of cultures. I'm honored to welcome Professor Ashis Nandy. We are privileged to have as our discussant today Professor Partha Chatterjee, who has distinguished himself as a historian, political scientist, and anthropologist, and more important, as one of our most respected social scientists and thinkers. He is, in fact, an inspiration to this university in the sense we are trying to create a community of composite social scientists, and he represents that rare species. I welcome Professor Partha Chatterjee. It's rare to, very seldom that we get to listen to Professor Nandy in an occasion in a public lecture forum like this in Delhi. It is also rare to, it's a rare occasion to listen to Professor Partha Chatterjee. But it's still rarer to have the confluence, the congregation of the combination of both of them here before us. It's like one of those interplanetary confluence. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege to welcome all of you to the fourth B.R. Ambedkar Memorial Lecture. There can be none better to introduce the speaker and the discussant to you, ladies and gentlemen, than my esteemed colleague, Professor Ashok Nagpal, renowned clinical psychologist and psychoanalyst and dean of our School of Human Studies. Professor Nagpal, please.
Thank you. I don't know about the early moment, how this will translate itself. Very nervous moment. But among certain pursuits that AUD follows with great pride, Ambedkar Memorial Lecture is one which we celebrate. Indeed, our inner experience might as well qualify closer to the child's fantasy of a grand event. For me, the fantasy of grand occasions is the one where everyone, or nearly everyone, can be together without needing to be self-aware of a distinctive center. It's more of an experience of surrender, of surround, of radiating, widening orbits of excitements. Yes, on such occasions, we see differently, we think differently, we listen differently, and we become different. We aspire to reach moments of exhilaration, standing ovation for sure, internally. A psychologist cannot do otherwise except to say that that is the point where we feel the stage beneath our feet. and we get introduced to one another radically. For me to be on this stage is to usher in this wave. Just usher in. Well, both our speakers need so special introduction, except insofar as their lives and works have rigorously attended to core concerns of human civilization. We're especially privileged today to have Professor Nandy and Professor Chatterjee here with us, but the task of finding an introduction for both of them unnerved me so much that I must say, I had to acknowledge the center by having a dream in the morning. And the dream was not an easy one. For good 45 minutes, as though I had kept an inner watch, I kept dreaming of libraries, of books. I think I heard a Bangla sound. The corridors went long and long and long, and I could finally wake out of the thing, finding that I had so many students growing me. I hope I didn't see Nivi amongst them. I hope I didn't see Mary amongst them. These are not people who need studenthood of this tradition of thinking, do they? But I think there were too many of them. It's as if we were looking out for a pathbreaker, for a trailblazer, someone who can bring politics, public life, subjectivity, local traditions, and to create an imagination of the future. As Professor Nandy puts it, the future, he says, I like to believe, belongs not to those who struggle to give technological teeth to our genocidal mentality, but to those who hone the tools of conviviality. I thought my dream was actually a way of being convivial, except that I was lost. So we expect Professor Nandy today to take us a little bit more by the very being of talking to us, sharing with us in those terrains of that subdisciplinary psychology where he says there is an experience of experience dwelling and we barely touch it. One hears poetry and music in his narration sometimes. At least that's what I managed to do in the dream. And I think he's a riot manager. He has often studied riot managers. He's a riot manager himself. He looks at the riotous emotions and manages to find a way of juggling so that you forget the subject-object divisions for a while. I think his works exemplify that human civilization hasn't even approximated the agenda of living nonviolently. So how do I introduce both of them? Both of them are scholars and soldiers in the same tradition. Both scholars have been much feted, much awarded, and it's my task now to ask them to come one by one to involve us in deepening of this thinking and being. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving me this honor of delivering this year's Ambedkar lecture. Thanks, Sam. Lecture. I'm very grateful to Vice Chancellor Menon and Professor Nagpal for the kind words they have said. You don't have to believe all of them. But I do believe and heart of hearts, all of them. I'm particularly glad that my wife and daughter also are here. I hope they will be a little less skeptic. I begin with a story. Because you will notice that a part of the title of this lecture is Dialogue of Cultures. 20 years ago, I would have called it a Dialogue of Civilizations. But I think civilization also excludes. The word comes from civil, civility, and over the centuries have been misused in a variety of ways. Some people have civilizations, others have only cultures. So I'm going to a more modest expression, dialogue of cultures. I once in a while use civilization, but on a very limited sense, in the sense of confederations of cultures. When I talk of Indian civilization, or Hindu civilization, or Islamic civilization, I have in mind that confederation of cultures, interplay of cultures. That's a different thing. I am here going to talk about more bilateral cultures, but that's also comes at the end. Let me start with a story to at least give you a hint the way I will end the lecture. About 30 years ago, a young American scholar, Stephen Thomas, read in some library of his university that for 5,000 years, 5,000 years ago, when the South Pacific islands were peopled, to find out more about it. After much inquiry, he was a student of anthropology. He found that one of the last traditional navigators who did not use any of the modern facilities of navigation, modern instruments of navigation, was still alive, a very old man then. And he decided to do his PhD by studying this man, and he went to this small island called Satavar and apprenticed himself to this navigator. And if you read his dissertation, which was later published as a book called The Last Navigator, you find a description of the way he learned the art and the science of navigation in the traditional way. This ancient mariner, this old man to whom he got apprenticed, was name was Pialuk. And he found out how this man, when navigating his boat, would read the winds, which way they were blowing, the speed of them, made a guess about it, the waves, the color of the ocean, why parts of it were bluish green and some parts of it were greenish green, that kind of thing. The birds, the flocks of birds flying over the water. The fish, shoals of fish moving through the water. Actually, literally, hundreds of variables relating to the sea, the boat, the flora and the fauna, because even sometimes he will make sense out of the floating leaves moving through the floating through on the water. And through these hundreds of variables, in a kind of a mental principal component factor analysis, he would make his decision and take the boat. Even the positions of the moon, the sun, the clouds, they were all relevant to him. And this chap, young chap, Stephen Thomas, this gives a very vivid and evocative description of the whole thing. Now, this is a skill, this is of navigation that has been made totally obsolete by modern navigational aids. You don't need to do all this. You have your compass, you have your radar, you have your sonar, you have computerized navigational systems, you have your GPS. It is totally unnecessary to go and apprentice Piyaluk, yourself to Piyaluk, to learn the skills this man learned. But the question remains that with the death of Piyaluk, the tradition that died, did it have something to offer to us as human beings? Did it contribute to our understanding of ourselves, our capacity to read nature, using an use of our own body and senses to navigate? Did that limit or shrink or abridge our experience of living? Stephen Thomas doesn't raise this question, but I think that is a question which is absolutely crucial to what I am going to say. The rest of it is an introduction to this. I will come to that. This time it will be boring because I am going to read large parts of it. Every generation likes to believe that it is living in momentous times, witnessing the death of one world and the birth of another. Everybody says that. Times are we are caught in change of times. We are living in a moment of fast social change. This is every generation believes that. The Bengali term for it used to be earlier, yuga sandikshana. This is kind of a, I'm pronouncing it the non-Bengali way, yuga sandikshan, we would say. This generation of Indians too believe that, that they are living through tumultuous times and negotiating large-scale social change. For their sake, I shall argue that along with the traditions in society and politics to which they like to stand witness, there are transitions in cultures of knowledge too. That's why I told the story, I began with it. Piyaluk represented a culture, not a civilization, but I'm going to come to that. They are witnesses to traditions of knowledge and cultures of knowledge of which they themselves are gloriously unaware. The categories we deploy to construct our world and our world images are parts of our innermost selves. And to disown them is to disown a part of ourselves and our self-esteem. Even when we try to shed them, they survive like phantom limbs do in many amputees. It is also a bit like one of Freud's three universal fantasies, immortality, the fantasy of immortality. When you imagine yourself dead, you are still there looking at yourself as dead. Human beings are incapable of imagining themselves as dead. Yet, with passage of time, the emancipatory concepts of one age are hollowed out. And through overuse and misuse, become for the next generation and next age poisoned gifts, sanctioning new forms of violence and oppression. I have always believed that human beings, given long enough time, adequate opportunities, and a culture of impunity, can turn any theory of liberation into its reverse. Such poisoned words continue to play a key role in public life and academic social sciences. Few talk of social Darwinism these days, but many cannot give up its sanitized version in a whole range of social evolutionary epithets. The ideas of developed and underdeveloped, advanced and backward, progressive and conservative, modern and traditional, are all derivatives of the crude Darwinism that came to us not only through thinkers like Herbert Spencer, at one time a well-known name in Indian academe. In fact, I have discovered that in Bengalis there are mentions of Herbert Spencer even in poetry and plays. But also through some of the more distinguished left Hegelians talking incessantly of historical stages and historical compulsions, stages of economic growth and development. Elsewhere, I have tried to show how evolutionary principles began to be applied to even human life cycle and early education, and how by the late 18th century, childhood had lost its intrinsic sanctity and legitimacy, and the child had become, almost by definition, an inferior, underdeveloped version of the adult who had to be guided sternly and coercively towards productive adulthood and normal, healthy citizenship. Those who are offended by many instances of child abuse in India would be surprised to hear that there were excellent flowing prose in praise of child labor, in the kind of works chimney sweeps did. And in some sections of the English society, it was customary to exchange children because you could not be too harsh on your own children and therefore you spoiled them. So you exchange children who worked in your friends or relatives' place as domestic helps, and their children would work at your place as domestic helps. That was the way to bring up children. I can go on giving there a lot of work on this now. This was as late as in Victorian England in 19th century. Later, the metaphor of life cycle was applied to entire societies and civilizations so successfully that even a humanist like Albert Schweitzer could not resist saying, "The African is my brother, but younger brother." I try to give here a very rough sketch of the overall environment in which social sciences grew and our theories of oppression carry the burden of their origins. I affirm they are contaminated. Let me start at the beginning. By the 19th century, the Enlightenment values had already made deep inroads into the middle class cultures of Europe and had begun to shape the continent's intellectual climate. Human beings were no longer toys of fate or plaything of gods. At the same time, simple domination, exploitation, and the marauding style of colonialism, Spain and Portugal pioneered in South America in the 17th and 18th centuries, was no longer acceptable. Self-interest had become legitimate by this time, but one had to give weighty reasons for one's greed and violence. Christianization of the pagan world and the absence of soul in American Indians and Africans were not enough. If you had to kill, rape, or rob, more secular causes like nationalism and sciences like biology, eugenics, and anthropology had to be invoked. In this ambience, Europe sired the birth of a whole new range of social thought that included a number of brand new theories of secular salvation. The new disciplines and strands of radical thought reshaped existing social knowledge and also entered the colonized societies through new educational initiatives and universities. Gradually, the likes of Jeremy Bentham, Robert Owen, James Mill, John Stuart Mill, Karl Marx, Herbert Spencer, whom I have already mentioned, William James, even Pyotr Kropotkin, Sigmund Freud, and Thorstein Veblen entered important pockets of urban middle-class awareness as a major presence and lasting influence in Europe. It was the high noon of modern colonialism. It was a time when well-intentioned, important thinkers in the northern hemisphere could not but think of the good of the entire world as their noblesse oblige. Dutifully, many of them proposed universal theories of oppression and human liberation. Unfortunately, almost all of them knew nothing about the non-European world. Fortunately, they did not allow that to cramp their style. I do not want to spend time on this part of the story, though. Thanks to a number of scholars, all this is better known today. I want to speak how, when some of the pioneers were busy claiming modestly that their theories and methods being timeless and transterritorial, their diverse and competing ventures began to show some common results. That's what I'm mainly going to do here. First, it became a general tendency in scholarly circles to translate space into time. This is not the physics translation of physics. This is a social science translation, a philosophical translation. To see geographically distant countries outside Europe and North America, countries which were at a distance from you and on the horizontal plane, as an earlier stage of history, that means you, the horizontal plane, you turn into a longitudinal plane, and became an earlier, this, so these distant societies became actually not distant, they became a past. As in fact, an earlier phase of Europe. So distant societies and strange societies no longer remained distant and strange. They became a familiar part of you because they are the past of Europe. That's what we were earlier. So universal brotherhood cannot handle this problem. It has to, gull that also. While the earlier generations in Europe had seen China and India as ancient civilizations that were exotic, rich, intriguing, and unique, now they began to see these countries as having impressive, if feudal, pasts, but trapped in recent centuries in decadent, dissolute, primitive social and religious practices and waiting to be engineered into something more contemporary by the young, vigorous, advanced European civilization. Second, in a related development, there emerged after the first flush of enthusiasm for social Darwinism, subtler social evolutionary theories of history, modernization, state formation, and later economic development. Whatever else these theories did or did not, they began with immense efficiency to steamroll, flatten, and secularize the diverse visions of a desirable society in African and Asian societies into a single monolithic vision. And this new shared vision of the future increasingly began to look like contemporary West Europe and North America. Today, this process has reached its apogee. 1 billion Chinese and 1 billion Indians seem to have internalized and eagerly bought into this utopia. Mimicking Oscar Wilde, one might say that the good Chinese and the good Indian, if they have lived a virtuous life, now go not to heaven, but to New York. Third, gradually, over the last 150 years, the marginalized and dominated of the world too have acquired an increasingly homogenized look in scholarly work, irrespective of their social location and cultural fissures. This is more true of not only scholarly, but this is more true of the public culture. That's all around us. Often, descriptions lifted from one part of the world in the 19th century are almost indistinguishable from descriptions from another part of the world in the 20th century. Indeed, this commonality cuts across the political and ideological boundaries of the theories deployed to interpret their plight. Ethnographers may not agree, but whether they're Dalits of India in the 21st century or the working class huddling in the gene alleys of industrializing England, be they the fishing communities in southern India resisting the encroachment of trawlers today, or the Maoris fighting colonization in New Zealand, the victims of structural and institutionalized violence and exploitation have been gradually acquiring the same look. The victims are being given a new two-dimensional identity. They are poor and they are oppressed. The victims are left with nothing except this identity in the civilized world. The theories that speak for them and look after their welfare are usually aggressively global. They have no time or patience for the lifestyles of individual communities, which in any case they, the theories, consider secondary. Fourth, while the oppressed and the poor remain a social category, a potentially revolutionary formation and a rebellious mob, and as such have agency only potentially. That is, after adequate conscientization, to borrow Paulo Freire's word, or mobilization, the oppressors seem to have agency here and now, on the basis of the historical role they have already played as innovative entrepreneurs, as a social sector having better scientific and technological knowledge, and above all, as self-aware citizens. Liberated intellectuals, vanguards of the proletariat, or simply as awakened, informed citizens. That's the difference. No? The oppressors are granted agency, not those who are oppressed. More recently, the legitimacy for this agency has become subtler and more difficult to combat. Dominance is increasingly dependent on categories. I believe it is the most important element of domination today, not political economy, not history, not institutionalized structural violence. Dominance is increasingly dependent on categories, not on institutional forces. In knowledge societies, dominance does not look like dominance if one can partition off one's professional self and subject it to knowledge hierarchy while ranting against social hierarchy. George Bernard Shaw's aphorism that all professions are a conspiracy against the laity may have become stale, but the idea of disabling profession in Ivan Illich has acquired a sharper edge. Fifth, the psychological climate I am trying to capture was founded on what was seen as the triumph of reason. The social theories the 19th century spawned during its transition from the culture of slavery to the culture of colonialism derived their values almost exclusively from reason. They broke with the tradition by not drawing their values from multiple sources, mainly transcendental or divine injunctions, compassion, aesthetics, and reason. The emphasis on reason as the primary or only source of values can have some virtues, I admit. I can imagine then that in societies that had maintained cultural continuities over centuries, reason must have appeared to many a new, liberating, and healthy vantage ground for social criticism. Afro-Asian intellectuals and social reformers took to the change like fish to water. But the violence of the 20th century has quite conclusively shown, and I'm talking empirically here, that reason in both its popular forms, as instrumental reason and as scientific rationality, can be an excellent sanction for genocide and dominance. Indeed, by using Rudolf Rummel's data on genocide, one can easily show that at least 20 times as many people have been liquidated in the name of reason and science in the last century than in the name of religious fanaticism, and this is probably an underestimation. Sixth, as new dichotomies were set up in the 19th century to describe the journey from the past to the future, one end of the dichotomies were always polarized, not the other. This perhaps was nothing terribly new or strange. At the beginning of Anna Karenina, Leo Tolstoy had said, all happy families are alike. Each unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. And in modern clinical disciplines, we all know one can be ill in myriad ways, but healthy in usually one way. In psychiatry, psychoanalysis and clinical psychology, you can be insane in a variety of interesting ways, but you can be sane within a much smaller, more boring range of options. However, in social knowledge and applied philosophy, such asymmetry can have serious implications. If you have a rich phenomenology of underdevelopment, but sparse work on varieties of development, or if you have a wide range of work on threats to national security, but only a unitary concept of national security, it obviously does something to our public imagination. In the last 5 decades, I have seen how transient and fragile have been attempts to pluralize the concept of development. I have seen gradually concepts like rural development, micro-development, alternative development, ethno-development, indigenous development, and sustainable development all fall on the wayside. Only one development survived, development with a capital D. More recently, in a country claiming to be the birthplace of Gandhi, the definition of national security has steadily become narrower as threats to national security have multiplied and become richer in descriptive contents, limiting the range of our public imagination and our policy options. No wonder our first response to all terrorism has become statist counterterrorism. I do not dismiss the efforts or the sacrifices of those studying or fighting human suffering and exploitation and trying to make sense of them. I myself work predominantly on the nastier side of life. But I do believe that we have hollowed out the lives and lifestyles of those who live under regimes of dominance and exploitation. I am not concerned here with those who have used social knowledge to openly justify slavery, colonialism, imperial wars, child labor, indentured labor, and genocide. I am concerned with the mind of those who deployed the dominant theories of oppression and human liberation. I am concerned that Frederick Engels justified the colonial conquest of Algeria by France because he felt the conquest of Algeria is an important and fortunate fact for the progress of civilization. I am disappointed that Karl Marx, who crossed the boundary of his ideology to congratulate Abraham Lincoln when he abolished slavery, never extended the same favor to the countries in the southern hemisphere. When it came to India, he argued that however exploitative and gory British colonialism, it would still manage to pull this unwilling country screaming and kicking into the modern world. His brainchild, the noted economist Joan Robinson, who lovingly brought up 2 generations of Indian students on her ideas of radical politics and economics, put it more bluntly. The only thing worse than being colonized, she used to insist, was not being colonized. I believe that most dominant theories of oppression and human liberation bequeathed to us have drawn legitimacy from 3 sources. The Baconian idea of scientific rationality, the social evolutionary ideas of historical compulsion and historical stages, and from the left Hegelian and the left Hegelian idea of state. The 3 together have been the core myths of our times, which have refused to die even at the beginning of the 21st century. Together, the triad has created a dangerous political psychological contradiction that shapes our intellectual life and defines our ideas of the progressive, the radical, and the developed or advanced. On the one hand, there has been an expansion of democratic awareness. On the other, there has emerged a new technocracy claiming intellectual and political leadership on the ground that it understands the technicalities of exploitation and dominance better than the actual victims have, and thus the right to be the voice of the people. The targeted beneficiaries have become a new laity, either lowly foot soldiers or passive spectators of their own liberation. The well-educated urban middle classes in this part of the world who fought the structures of oppression around them we are brought up on these ideas. They resented the ruthlessness of the colonial state and the reality of exploitation, but not the categories and the worldview that sanctioned the ruthlessness and the exploitation. They had internalized the imperial categories and suffered from an acute deficit in self-esteem. They chose to fight imperialism from within its own frame. This is as true of those we call the left as those we call the right. The Hindu nationalist, Hindu nationalist Damodar Vinayak Savarkar, the father of Hindu nationalism, who wrote the Bible of it, Hindutva. Damodar Vinayak Savarkar, freedom fighter and the father of Hindu nationalism, hated Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi for his lack of scholarship, unscientific mind, and of all things, absence of familiarity with modern European political theory. It shows where from he got his ideas. In fact, that was what was floating around in European environment. It never struck Savarkar that others may have liked Gandhi as a path-breaking politician for exactly the same reasons, because he was an outsider, unimpressed by the authority of university-based knowledge systems, especially modern science and European concept of statecraft and radical politics. If you read Savarkar with genuine empathy and not like a police sub-inspector writing a first information report, you will find that except for a few peripheral concepts here and there, there is almost nothing Indian about his ideas of state, nation, and nationality. They are charmingly antique, borrowed from 19th century Europe. In them, his hostility to the Muslim overlies his savage criticism of the Hindus as a non-Martian, non-masculine, unorganized, fractious nationality in the making. And his not so secret admiration for the Muslims for being more martial and for being better human material for running a modern state. Savarkar did believe that the Europeans had earned the right to read the Vedas and the Upanishads, not the Indians. The Indians, he felt, were at a stage when they should read as Shudras, only Western textbooks of science and technology. This is from his own writing, I'm quoting. Conformity can never be as dangerous as tamed, defanged, predictable dissent. For such dissent allows the dominance to become hegemonic. This is the main theme of the lecture. At the same time, that such dissent allows itself to be monitored, scrutinized, co-opted, and efficiently managed with minimal use of force, because it is understandable, it is transparent, that it is accessible, because it is within the frame of those who have the agency in an oppressive system. It can even become an ornament, such dissent, and a testimonial to a system that it tolerates it, and even an endorsement of its democratic credentials, because it allows such dissent. What we are trying to do to the dispossessed and the marginalized in our midst, to the tribals, the Dalits, and the predominantly artisan Otishudras, is exactly what the Western intellectual establishment has sought to do to us. This is the core psychodynamics of intellectual imperialism in our time. I proposed that one of the first tasks of social knowledge in India today is to return agency to the communities at the receiving end of the system, who are now only poor and oppressed. We can do so only if we can take seriously the various cultural modes of self-expression of these communities. Democracy is a slow-moving, blundering, often ineffective tool in the case of small communities. But it still remains a powerful, enabling device for those not pushed to the margins of desperation. And some communities are pushed to the margin of desperation. However, our first responsibility is to open a dialogue with the cultures of the oppressed, not for the sake of their sake, but for ours. That's the important part. I underscore this, that we open a cultural dialogue not for their sake or mutual benefit, it's for the sake of ours. There are a number of reasons for this, but the most important of them is that if oppression has been community-based, resistance has to be so too. So, in fact, we are very thankful that, should be thankful in a way, that Indian politics is so caste-based or community-based, because you can mobilize communities only as communities. Dialogue of civilizations and cultures has become a fashionable and somewhat ubiquitous intellectual pastime these days. These dialogues have tried to bring into conversation people, countries, and communities in conflict when normal statecraft has failed to make them talk with each other. But what about the dialogue among cultures within the same nation state, when cultures in conflict cannot talk with each other, because both cultures, even when living within the same nation state, are two different countries? I think the Dalit and the tribal communities of India now constitute two formations of culture about which others know little and are convinced that they need to know nothing. A dialogue with them can only humanize our polity, make it richer, more informed democracy. A dialogue involves crossing borders, cultural, political, and above all, within those who are joining dialogues, the psychological borders. When we cross these borders, we are supposed to get a new, more empathetic understanding of the others we are looking at the world and us. There is an unrecognized assumption in this proposal. Others are never entirely strangers. There are also temptations and possibilities within us. We are what we are because we are shaped by these seductions within us. Their hatreds also are determined partly by that, because if the other is representing this seduction, then you stray, you hold them responsible. A dialogue may break stereotypes more easily than erase these partly alien fragments of ourselves within us, at least partly alien fragments within ourselves, operating as anti-selves and rejected selves. Our creativity and our destructiveness are both depends on how we grapple with these inner vectors. Elsewhere, I've tried to show that our creativity often is its most deepest and most profound when we are able to set up an anti-self within ourselves. You host an anti-self. Only then can we claim to have opened India to the other India where the Dalits and the tribals live. 100 years after formal decolonization, small sectors of post-World War II democracies are at last showing some signs of offering resistance to the obscenity of speaking on behalf of the oppressed and the exploited. And some of the victims too are now obstinately refusing to fit into the mind model of a one-dimensional life as the poor and the exploited, as only the poor and the exploited, perpetually dependent on experts and ideologues who have become their voices and guides to a better future. Pity and sympathy after a point can be degrading and vulgar. Instead of shedding copious tears for the poverty and exploitation of the Dalits and the Adivasis, the time has come to celebrate their self-affirmation and the enormous diversity of cultural, ecological, artistic, technological, and intellectual riches these communities have nurtured over the millennia. I do not believe that in these communities, grandparents do not tell stories to their grandchildren, and mothers do not sing lullaby to their babies. There are impressive ethnographic accounts of the hilly traditions, technological knowledge, and agronomic practices of some of these communities. Now there are even some interest in their distinctive cuisines, and there has been a serious interest in their artistic traditions. All this can be a reasonable vantage ground to launch the search for different worldviews and different visions of the future. I am tempted to adopt the plea of the Zapatistas that I picked up from Gustavo Esteva, my friend. The challenge today is nothing less than to host the otherness of others. To host the otherness of others. We have been terribly busy all these decades hosting the sameness of others. Dialogue of cultures can acquire a new depth if it engages communities and cultures at the receiving end of the system and reaffirms their right to intellectual dignity. The oppressed do have their own theories of oppression and have no obligation to be guided by our ideas of the scientific, the rational, and the dignified, and they have every right to be historically, economically, and politically incorrect. I started with a story, let me end with a story. I had a friend who is now dead. Ravi Mathai, who used to be the director of the Ahmedabad Institute of Management. And Apart from that, he used to run a development, voluntary development agency in a village of leather workers, charmakas, chamars. Chamar has become a word of abuse nowadays, I am told. I don't see why, but there it is. Modern technology and access to market to this community in a village. And it was a grand success. Most of the village, it was Dalit village as I told you, most of the village took to it happily and enthusiastically. But then there was this one old cobbler who just wouldn't budge, just wouldn't listen. So this information reached Ravi Mathai, and he decided to go and visit this cobbler and try to convince him that he should participate in this venture. So he met this obstinate, recalcitrant old cobbler and asked him, told him that everybody in the village seemed to be open to change except him. And they had all become more prosperous than him. The cobbler said that he was happy with what he had and did not want to change because he did not need anything more. So Mathai said, but your own brother has now taken to new technology and he's made a great success of it. He's very prosperous. He said, yes, I know that he's very prosperous now and he is making a lot of money, but I also notice that he is a more tense and anxious person now, and his expenses have gone off enormously, so he's always worried whether he will get the money tomorrow or not. And in fact, instead of being happy with the extra money he's making, extra money has made him more anxious and worried. So then Mathai was, after a 10-minute talk, Mathai was desperate. And as a last resort, he said, you know, people are saying behind your back that you live in the 18th century. Others have moved into the 20th century. You are 2 centuries behind them. The old cobbler very proudly said, but I decide which century I want to live in. This can be seen as a romantic, nostalgic posture. This can also be seen, I like to believe, as an affirmation of autonomy and freedom, even if he is strong, even if he could have done better in the other way, because that will be our decision, not his. And I end with this story to say that the person in whose honor this lecture series has been established, you know, had other ideas. He didn't share my ideas. He was a classical liberal. People forget that. Now they're trying to make him a grand radical. But he was a proper, well-trained classical liberal who wanted constitutional means of government. So I do believe that the oppressed have a right there too. They have no obligation to go by our theories of violence. They can opt for exactly the kind of things I'm criticizing here. That right is also open to it. So in some sense, this lecture is a homage to, a paean to, if you like, to human autonomy, which over the years, in the name of enlarging the autonomy, we have gradually abridged. Thank you very much for your patience.
I'd prefer to make my comments from here rather than, it's very hard to follow Ashishda on the pulpit. So Let me first thank the organizers of Ambedkar University for this event. It is a great honor and privilege for me to be sharing the podium, although I, as I said, that it's very difficult to follow Ashisda on the podium, so I've decided to speak from here. But to share the stage with Ashis Nandy, in fact, let me just confess, I probably would not have agreed to do this event had it not been Ashis Nandy's lecture. This is no disrespect to Ambedkar, but many people here know my allergy to academic events in this city, and it takes a lot of persuasion for people to make me agree to do this. But this one I agreed to do with great enthusiasm, because Ashis Nandy has been truly an inspiration, even though I have not always agreed with what he has said. I was just reminded of one of my college teachers who used to teach political theory, who told us that he believed that every great thinker had only one important thing to say. There was only one important idea. Then, no matter how many volumes their collected works, there was really one idea. Now, at the time, I was not persuaded by this. I thought I was, you know, this was trivializing great thinkers. But the older I've become, I've realized that, in fact, that's very true. And so I can announce that I truly believe Ashis Nandy has always had, through all his writings, just one important thing to say. And as I say this not as an 18-year-old college student, someone who's you know, seen and read a fair amount, but that one important thing is, I believe, the question of why it is that there is so much violence and oppression and hatred in the modern world. In a sense, this is paradoxical, because we celebrate modernity precisely for its humanity and its ability to make life healthier and better and more enjoyable and everything else. I'm sure none of us really wants to go back to live in the 15th century. And yet it is true that, as Ashisda has never failed to point out, the scale and intensity of violence in the 20th century has probably been more than ever in human history. And I believe this is really the fundamental question that has driven almost everything that Ashisda has thought about and written about and spoken about in, well, I've been reading him since the early 1970s. So today's lecture, I think, is no different. He has once again elaborated on his fundamental theme. I think there is one very interesting twist that he's provided at the end. I'll come to that in a minute, which will lead me to ask him two questions. This being a formal thing, I was told there was not going to be a question-answer session at the end, but Ashisda has agreed that if he's sufficiently provoked by me, he was going to respond. So I will ask him a couple of questions at the end. But let me try and bring the discussion to in the direction that I want to take it, which is to actually divide up his lecture into two parts. There were, I think, two different things. He began with the question of democracy, but there were two parts. One was the question of education. What is it that is involved in one group of people claiming that they are more knowledgeable, more wise than others, and therefore should have a pedagogical role in educating other people? That is one part of his talk. The other part is the question of democracy. And I think there is, if one looks at it this way, these two parts are actually not consistent with. There is an asymmetry between these two things. They are, in fact, there is a contradiction between the idea of democracy and the idea of education. And I think this is what I would like to push towards. You see, this whole idea of, this is where Ashisda began with the question of childhood and immaturity and why it is that, let us say, in the classic colonial relationship, the Western powers believed, and they truly believed in the 19th century, you will find enormous amounts of material where the most leading thinkers, and we did not condemn them for being unsympathetic or uncaring or anything like that at all, but leading thinkers were completely persuaded by the idea that the Western nations, being the most advanced, had an educative role in bringing other peoples to the required levels of civilization and modernity. It was a pedagogical function, and this is how colonialism began to be justified from the early 19th century onwards, and we've heard this, we still hear it. Now, if one looks back at where this idea comes from philosophically, I think at least in the English-speaking tradition, perhaps the key text here, at least for me, is John Locke, classic liberal philosophers, classic founding father almost of liberal political philosophy. And in Locke's description of what he called the Commonwealth, he described who could be the members of the Commonwealth, who constituted the citizens, as we would describe them today. Who were the citizens? Now, the citizens, of course, were men. I mean, for him, by definition, women did not belong here. So he spends very little, few sentences describing why women could not be members of the Commonwealth. And then, after various other exclusions, such as, for instance, property, you had to have property because otherwise you did not have a sufficient stake in the Republic, in the Commonwealth. But there are two exclusions which otherwise seem very, very innocuous and almost self-evident. These two exclusions were children, and he clubs these two together, lunatics and idiots. Now, for him, he doesn't spend a very long time justifying why they could not be parts of the Commonwealth, but even today we would think it's obvious that children could not be voting members, for instance, of a political community, because of course children are not mature enough to make judgments about their own conditions, about their futures and so on, and therefore somebody else has to make the judgment on their behalf. We think of it as almost self-evident. Lunatics and idiots also are excluded precisely for the same reason that they say people who cannot exercise their reason cannot be proper members of a Commonwealth. Now, this description became, as it were, a fundamental, almost structural condition in the justification of colonial rule. This was fundamentally the first part of Ashisda's lecture today, what he was describing. The idea that people outside Europe, in the other parts of the world, in Asia and Africa, these people were like children. They did not have sufficient maturity to decide on their own fate, that they could not be political because they were not mature enough, and that therefore it was the responsibility of their educators, namely Western powers, to bring them, to to provide them with the necessary knowledge and skills and so on in order to make them sufficiently skilled in running modern societies and states. And because within colonialism, therefore, there was no question of there being democracy in the relationship between the colonizers and the colonized. Clearly, for exactly the same reason that Locke believed that children could not be proper members of the Commonwealth. Obviously, Asians and Africans could not have self-government. They could not be given democracy, precisely because they were incapable of exercising it. Now, alongside this, therefore, there was the other structure of the polity, and you can expand the idea of the polity into any kind of systems of power. The other structure there was, this was fundamental to colonial rule, so therefore what would be the structure that would guide the relations between colonizers and the colonized? And the model for this was what in the 18th century used to be called enlightened despotism. It was despotism. It would have to be some form of despotic power, authoritarian power, but it would be enlightened because there would be reason. The colonizers would be guided by the enlightened forms of reason in carrying out their pedagogical role. Now, those two things I would like you to think about, because if you think of democracy and if you think of that pedagogical function, then, strictly speaking, within the space of democracy, there can be no pedagogical function. Within the space of democracy, there can be, no one can educate anybody else. Because, in fact, the fundamental assumption is that each member of the Commonwealth, each person who is recognized as a citizen is equal, is of equal worth, is of equal value, precisely because that person is assumed to have exactly the same capacity to make judgments, to make decisions about public matters as anybody else. So whether it is Ashis Nandy or me, or whether it's the domestic help in our homes, or the farmers who are growing the food that we eat, all of us are exactly equal. There can be no educational role between us and them. The only form, therefore, this, if you actually put it starkly, then in fact, within, if you have an educational space, as we do in a classroom, for instance, then the form of power there is expected to be that of enlightened despotism. There is authority on one side, there is a way of exercising power which the teacher has, precisely because the understanding is that the teacher knows certain things more than the student does, and therefore there is a relation of hierarchy there implicitly. We can humanize it and so on, we can do it, you know, make it as palatable as possible. But, and that precisely is the function of reason here. We have to be reasonable and enlightened and so on. But it is enlightened despotism which is, properly speaking, the form of power in education. So now let me pose the problem that Ashisda has actually posed for us. That problem is, what is the relationship between communities or between cultures? Is it a relationship of democracy or is it a relationship of pedagogy or education? Right? And this is where I think certain kinds of complicated problems do arise, that's precisely the sorts of questions I would ask Ashisda to respond to. One of the things that he's highlighted very strongly, and I think very persuasively, is the sort of homogenization of the idea of the oppressed people. This homogenization has come about in more recent times, maybe one might even say in the last century, perhaps even less, maybe even in the last 50 years or so, where there is, broadly speaking, not just in what we call the social scientific disciplines, but even more generally in public discussions and public debates everywhere. An idea of the oppressed as victim and a certain assumed condition of victimhood, right? Where irrespective of the specific form of oppression, of the relation between those who are supposedly oppressing and the oppressed, which can, in concrete terms, vary a great deal from situation to situation, from country to country, from community to community, profession to profession, and so on. But there is a certain general sense that, of course, victimhood is bad, oppression is bad, and that there is some general formula in dealing with oppression as a phenomenon. And usually this is framed within a, you know, certainly in the last 30 or 40 years ago, you have a whole series of discourses about rights, for instance, human rights, et cetera, which have become a very major way of speaking about oppression and how to fight oppression or resist oppression. But there is a homogenization. What Ashisda has actually highlighted is the need to pay more attention to the varieties of lifestyles that are involved in the idea of modern oppression. That the varieties, that the lifestyles involved, the communities involved, and the specific forms of oppression involved are not all the same. And these varieties are important because it is only in terms of recognizing those varieties that we might actually create that space where the oppressed people themselves may be able to have a voice, to actually be able to say what it is that they object to. Because it is not a formulaic resistance. It is not a formulaic thing which anybody can pull out of a textbook and say, well, this is oppression, this is what is happening there, right? Because what Ashisda, I think, has highlighted is that the process of representing the oppressed has also been taken over by those of us who actually belong fully within the oppressing communities. That it is experts. We have produced our own experts who are experts at representing the voice of the oppressed, right? This is where I think the key question then becomes, what are the grounds on which this has happened? This has not simply happened because there have been some, you know, wicked people who've thought this up. It's happened because there have been good philosophical and political grounds on which this phenomenon of members of so-called advanced communities or more powerful communities, members from those communities, as it were, going over to the other side and representing the case for the oppressed. This has happened certainly in the forms of modern politics, certainly from the 19th century onwards, and there are many, many political varieties in which this has happened. I think the key argument here is once again the pedagogical one, that the ground on which this has happened is precisely the idea that the oppressed need to be educated, that left to themselves, they are unable to fight. That left to themselves, they are condemned to defeat. Because in fact, their oppressors are so much more powerful and so much more knowledgeable and skilled at wielding the instruments of power. Therefore, those who know from the inside how the state works and how the police works and how the legal system works right, and how the modern economy works, that those are the people who are best able to actually advise and teach the oppressed people on how to fight. Now, this was the basis for many of the political movements of the 19th and 20th centuries, the entire tradition of, you know, socialist and communist organizations and agitations were built on this, and there have been numerous others, including the nationalist movements, the Gandhian movements. They have all shared this idea of a pedagogical function, that people from that sections from the advanced communities have felt it necessary to carry out. So therefore, if that is true, that is to say, if, in fact, so let me then pose my, or formulate the elements of my first question to Ashishta, that if we accept that there is a pedagogical function possible between communities, that is to say, communities may learn from one another, which would mean that there could be an educative role between members of one community in relation to another, right? Then, is Ashishda's argument that this pedagogical function is actually illegitimate, and that that is really what is the problem? That we should not even pretend and try to educate other communities and other peoples. If, on the other hand, because if that pedagogical function is granted, then it seems to me that you cannot prevent whether, you know, revolutionary organizers or NGOs or advocacy groups or any of these kinds of people, you cannot prevent or you cannot take away the ground on which that kind of activity actually operates. Of course, it could be said that this educational function need not take place only in one direction. That is to say, it need not be the case that only the so-called advanced community will teach the others, that in fact, those of us who think we are more knowledgeable and more wise and more skilled and so on, might have something to learn from those who are trying to educate, right? So in fact, this pedagogical function might work or should work both ways. That could be a response. In other words, accepting the pedagogical role between communities, we could say that this pedagogical role is not necessarily only in one direction, that it should operate in both directions. In fact, it's very interesting that even Karl Marx, whom I think Ashis Nandy is right in criticizing on the things that he has criticized Marx for. But Marx himself did talk about, although rather cryptically, of educating the educators, which is an important part of what he wanted to build into the idea of a movement that moves towards socialism. But anyway, if in fact the moderns or the advanced have something to learn, and this is where I think the discipline of ethnography or anthropology, as Ashita has pointed out, has actually worked quite effectively, certainly in the last sort of 50, 60 years, to actually make the case that not only have moderns learnt from the so-called primitives, but they might still have things to learn from the primitives. And that's one of the reasons why, as Ashita said, the whole idea of civilization, that construct has in fact been discredited, is precisely because, and substituted by the idea of cultures, precisely to say that all cultures, in a sense, have worth, unlike the distinction between the civilized and the uncivilized. So that is an achievement of the discipline of anthropology. And it's in through ethnography that, in fact, one has become aware of the enormous debt that advanced cultures, or sophisticated cultures of every part of the world, the enormous debt that they have to the so-called less developed or more primitive communities. I mean, there are a whole range of things, from whether, you know, practical knowledge of things like medicine and healing and so on and so forth, to things like food, to things like clothes, to things, to a whole range of artifacts and so on, which have become part of sophisticated living, which actually have their origins in the lives and work of supposedly less advanced or primitive peoples. And ethnography has been one of the major means through which this has been demonstrated. So if we come to that part, so therefore the first question is there a pedagogical role possible? If so, should it work both ways? If it works both ways, then what would be the criticism then? What would be the status of the criticism that Ashish has been making about the role of the moderns in ignoring the contribution or the autonomy of the oppressed peoples? So that's the first question. But secondly, moving on from there, this would be my second question, and I actually have only those two questions. That if, in fact, borrowings, cultural borrowings, have happened, and they've happened through history, this is not something that's a recent thing. I mean, for instance, if one looks at the more sophisticated ways of living of the elite in India, in virtually every regional culture, as I said, that from food to a whole range of daily or ceremonial practices. In fact, very interestingly, for even traditionally, you know, the Dharmashastra writers made the distinction between those kinds of rituals that were properly shastric and those which they classified as lokachar or deshachar. And ethnography has now demonstrated very, very well that a great deal of what goes under the name of lokachar is actually local, tribal, completely non-Brahminical sorts of practices, which have entered into the lifestyles of the more elite sections of society, every part of India. So that it's not as though these kinds of transactions have never taken place. If they have taken place, then this is the interesting problem that Ashishda has highlighted, that these borrowings become appropriations, right? For instance, you can think of healing practices which were part of local knowledge somewhere. A great deal of the healing practices, let's say the properties of, you know, medicinal properties of various plants, they have often entered into modern scientific knowledge. They've been adopted. They've been taken over. Those specific properties have been established through modern, let's say, chemical analysis and so on and so forth. Once they've been appropriated, they've become part of modern knowledge. That's no longer the property of anything that's acknowledged as having been borrowed, right? They simply become part of a hegemonic formation of knowledge. It has happened through history. It is continuing to happen. But the problem that Ashishda has highlighted, I think, very properly, is that this kind of borrowing from one culture to another, if there is a relationship of hierarchy, of power between those two communities, they become appropriations and actually contribute to a hegemonic formation. So this raises, once again, this very difficult question then. Should the answer therefore be no borrowings, no transactions? Is that what autonomy would actually require? Or if there is actual borrowing and transaction between communities. What would be the terms? Now, it seems to me that whereas borrowings and so on have happened all the time, the reason why this has become particularly problematic today, and that's exactly the problem that Ashita has highlighted, the difficulties with it is posed by the conditions, which is a very, very contemporary condition. It's a modern condition, which is now going back once again to those two parts of Ashish's argument. It is the condition of democracy that makes it so difficult. Because you see, democracy insists on a condition of equality. I've told you before how difficult it is within the space of equality that is assumed and defined by democracy, how difficult it is to define any kind of pedagogical relationship. So this difficulty that we're facing now, all of the debates over, let's say, Dalit assertion or Adivasi assertion and so on that we see, we hear now, is the particular potency is acquired by the general condition, the general political condition, which is one of democracy, which demands that there be equality. So if there is equality between communities exactly in the same way that voters at a polling booth enjoy equality, if there is to be equality, then this is my second question. If there is to be exchange or dialogue between cultures, how can that be ensured under the conditions of equality, which is what democracy insists on? Because it seems to me that if the conditions, if the public conditions, the institutional conditions within which these communities are to be ruled, there was a time 300 years ago or 500 years ago or whenever, when those conditions under which different communities were ruled, the forms of polities, the forms of states were also different. Tribal communities in India were not ruled even if they were formally, let's say, under the Mughals and so on. They actually had owed no allegiance to anything like a Mughal constitution. But today they have to. You see, this is the key problem today, that there is a formal condition of equality. There is a condition of equality where the form of the state, the forms of rule, the forms of the institutions that shape and condition the daily lives of different communities of people, those institutional forms are in a sense homogenized. They are roughly the same everywhere. So in these conditions, if, let us say, an oppressed community insists that we will have autonomy, in other words, rule our lives in the way we want, then are we then going to say, well, the forms of rule then must also be different for each community? But that is not something we are quite prepared to say, because we also think that it is important and valuable that this edifice of a modern state that we've built up with, based on the conditions of equal citizenship for everybody and so on, the law applying equally to everybody, is also a valuable thing. Then how can we keep both of those things together? So therefore, that becomes my second question then. Is it a question of the autonomy that Ashishda is insisting on? Or is it a question of a dialogue of cultures on the premise of equality? How could we have those two things? In fact, so therefore, you know, finally to end with on Ambedkar, Ashish is completely right. Ambedkar was one who was totally convinced of the need for a modern polity, a modern liberal constitutional polity where there would be genuine equality. But Ambedkar also did not deny the pedagogical role. And I think it is arguable that within the constitutional framework and so on that he had thought about, this contradiction which has now emerged or is emerging more and more powerfully was not something that whose implications he had quite anticipated. And one can certainly say that the answers are not quite there in Ambedkar. These are things that we'll have to work out for ourselves or future generations, not the people of Ashishda or my generation. This will have to be worked out by others here. So I'll end there. Thank you.
I shall frankly take not more than 2 or 3 minutes. Firstly, to thank Partha for his excellent comments. I have learned a lot. And yes, so beautifully he's posed the three questions. Actually, there are three questions here, not two. But I cannot give offhand a casual answer to this. One has to think about it, because what the problems he raises are crucial. I do, however, want to make two brief points. One, that I do feel sympathetic to works which deny the role of pedagogy, or at least ask for a more limited role of pedagogy in our lives. I think that is possible because learning outside pedagogy is also a possibility. And I look at dialogue primarily as a means of posing a challenge or a provocation. Partha has started by saying that he hopes his comment will be a provocation to me. A provocation, but different persons and different cultures, for that matter, provide different kind of provocations. And that provocation is constantly a challenge to us to expand ourselves. I do not think cultures, or for that matter, even civilizations, are entities where there are large gaps of knowledge on one side or on both sides. I believe that when you are talking of culture as a repertoire of skills, repertoire of imaginations, and a repertoire of creativity, creative forms, modes of self-expression, is a entity which, if you can be in and have a human encounter, can always learn on itself, learn by itself. Indeed, I would go further and affirm that one of the clues to creativity, for many years I studied human creativity. Whenever I get tired of actually human destructiveness, I go to creativity. And whenever I get bored with that, I come back to this, human violence. But one of the clues to creativity is how far, and that's why I found this saying of the Japatistas very appropriate, hosting the otherness of others. Because hosting the otherness of others, not the sameness of others, where we are common, where we have the same ideas, we share it, same ideas, same laws, same conventions, same rituals, but where it's a provocation or a different, it expands your boundaries, it expands the boundaries of yourself. And that is why, if you look at the works of great creative artists, you will often find that in the greatest works of theirs, they have set up this anti-self within the work. That it's not outside, but within it. Kipling's greatest work was Kim. And the Lama in Kim is a total negation of Kipling that we know, in ideology, in values, and emphasis on compassion and certain kind of sensitivity to human relations. He's just the reverse of Kipling. And that negation Kipling could host in this novel. And in some sense, the novel becomes transcends Kipling's limitations as a person and his ideological how should I put it, trap in which he was caught, and liberates him also. This was not pedagogy, this was learning. And probably not even learning, it was not self-conscious learning. It was intuitively picked up. So that's one point I would like to say. Perhaps I can also add that human collectivities also learn from their own past and their own futures. I do not believe that there can be an objective construction of the past or an objective construction of the future. But the visions, scenarios of the future which you toy with, play with, or the construction of the past which you own up and which you try to then defy, gives you a different kind of play, that in within you there are the potentialities. And that is why I emphasize this idea, I put it very loosely and probably inappropriately, that I call them temptations and seductions, I think. No, some temptations and something else, I forget now. The idea was that in any human encounter, there is always this sense of recognition, whether consciously or unconsciously, that his way of ways is actually a challenge to some of my ways. And the way you react to that, you know, it can be, that challenge can be picked up as a possibility. That challenge you can also reject as a seduction which you want to fight. So both are possible. And to the extent you can do that, enlarges the range of yourself. In some sense, you transcend yourself to and you transcend not only yourself but your limitations too. I think after this, this is enough of a response to his, because I've learned much. I'm humbled by your comments, and I will make use of them. Thank you very much.